Hey friends, welcome to my channel. My name is Alexander Richter. I'm a technical director for visual effects, animation and games. And today I'm in Sentul in Indonesia. And what we want to talk about is how to use code as an artist. Run the intro. One of the key elements of today's work is becoming more and more technical. If we work in a 3D field, especially in visual effects, animation, and games, the whole work becomes kind of technicalized, and a lot of elements go into create our work. And of course, there are the side of the artistic work and there are the side of the technical work, and they all work together to create the movie or the game. And one of the things that I also see for artists specifically, that they sometimes want to reach out and work with a little bit of code to help themselves to create faster and to create better work. And I think there is a little bit of a steep learning curve of not being a technical director, not being a scripter, but still using some kind of snippet of code that either one of your colleagues provides, you found somewhere on the internet that sounds good and you want to use it in your work, but you kind of have a problem of understanding what's going on and how to use it properly so it really enhances your work. How can we use some specific code from outside that is a few lines or a few dozen lines long that we as artists who are not trained in scripting or programming can still integrate it in our work and use it as if we wrote it ourselves? So how do we do that? There are two simple questions we have to ask ourselves when we work with someone else's code, even though we are not scripter or programmer. And these two questions are, what does the script do? And how can I modify it to make it work for our goals? And that is actually the two questions. If you can answer them, you can basically work with someone else's work, especially if you don't understand all the pieces, because you only focus on the things that matter to you. Let's try an example. In our case, we have a specific example where we get the current scene path. So we get a few snippets, basically two lines of code that someone gave us that help us in our current situation. So we have two lines in Maya. One is import maya.cmds as cmds. And the second line is cmds.file. And then in round brackets, q equals true and sn equals true. As artists, we have no clue what that means. There is a lot of gibberish going on and we are wondering, what should we do with it? Let's bring back our questions. First question, what does it do? Of course, most of the time we know what a script is doing if we downloaded it or someone gave it to us. So in this case, it gets the current scene path. So this script specifically will tell us what is the current scene path of the scene that we currently have open. So we know the specific path that we currently have open in Maya. First question solved. So means if we use this script, we will get the current scene path. The second question, and probably the most important question, is how can we modify it or change it to use it for ourselves? For that, we have to look at what exactly does the script do. So in this case, we have to figure out where is the information that we want. In our case, it's actually the second line, cmds.file, which gets us the current scene path and allows us to basically extract where the scene path is going. So this is the most important line for us. The first line we don't really get, but it is not important for the specific situation. So if we want to do something regarding the scene path, we have to modify this line to change things up, maybe to save it in a variable, maybe to print it out, and so on. And that way we basically figured out, what does the script do? It gets us the current scene path. And where do we have to modify it? We have to modify the second line, and especially deciding what we have to change and do with the second line to get a printout, to change maybe the result, not the scene path, but maybe the scene name. So we have to probably change one of the attributes instead of SN equals true, maybe someone else. But also here, even if we understand that far, we can always ask someone else and be very specific on what we want to change and where we want to bring the script for us to work. Let's try the same approach on a little bit more of a complex example. In this case, we have a function called snap to first selection. So the question is, what does it do? And in this case, the explanation is you select multiple objects in the scene, in this specific case in Maya, and then it will snap all the objects to your first selection. So if you select three objects, here, here, and here, this is the first object. So this object and this object will automatically be snapped to this one. Great, we answered the first question. What does it do? It snaps all the selected object to the first selection. The next part is, of course, there's now multiple lines. We probably don't know any of them or just have a basic understanding what they do. What we now have to figure out, how can we modify it to our needs? Let's say we want to do something else. Let's say we want to snap it to the second selection for some reason. So we look at the code and then we figure out, okay, the first line is called selection and it does something like cmds.ls. So it's probably getting all the selected objects in the scene together. The next line, if selection bigger than one, okay, then you can see selection tx, ty, and tz, transform probably tx, ty, and z. And then there is a for asset in selection. We now have the situation where, yes, of course, we are not super experienced in the whole situation, but since we focus only on how to modify this, for example, to snap it to the second selection, we basically think, okay, where is the anchor point of, instead of snapping it to the first selection, to snap it to the second selection? And if we look about that, we can see on the fifth line, basically, we have this selection collections that we have to modify to, for example, snap everything to the second selection. And if we know a little bit about programming, and again, not always everything is as smooth as it sounds like, we know that lists and so on starts at zero. So the first object starts at 0, 1, 2, 3. So it means there is this selection 0. If we change that to selection 1, it means we will take the attributes of the second selection and then apply that in the next lines to the rest, and they will snap to the second selection instead of to the first selection. A little bit more tricky for sure, would be better for us if we have a background in that, but because we are laser focused in how can we modify and we understand what we want to do exactly with the script, we just focus on where to find this specific result because we know what it does and we search what it does inside the code and then we modify it to what it should be doing. And in this case, again, of course, we need to kind of interpretate, and the most important part, we have to try it. Just change a few things, try it out, see if it works. If it doesn't, roll it back, change something else and see if that works and it gives us the result that we want. And try and error is definitely a big part of it because we don't have the background in scripting, but combining these two questions with practical try and error, I think is the best way to take a script that we don't really understand, but because we know what it does and where's the point to tweak it, we can basically tweak it until we find the exact number, the exact situation, and then we change the script to being abstract and maybe not specifically for us, to a script that does exactly what we want. To summarize, if we are artists and we still want to work with code, even though we're not scripters at all, the best way to approach it is to be laser focused on what it currently does and what we want it to do, especially if we want to modify it to our specific needs. And that way we can basically understand the code by focusing on the mixture between what is there, and then we look what is there and see where is the anchor point that we need to change to get it to our level, to get it to our functionality. And that way we can basically remove most of the code and just focus on the few lines that we need to modify to get the results that we want. Thank you very much for listening. I hope you enjoyed the series, and I will see you on the next video. Check out my website alexanderrichtertd.com if you're interested in more content like articles, masterclasses, and coaching opportunities to work successfully in the industry.